Today, we are going to talk about arguably the most abundant but least understood phenomena of our lives. Yes, social media. Some 9 years back, I believe I got rebirth when I got introduced to this phenomena in my personal life. Then the journey continued over the period of years as user, observer, analyst, staunch social media supporter, and trainer in all over Maharashtra. I realized in this journey that our every click is part of one bigger phenomena which takes place in the background, and hence we don't know about it. Today, in coming few minutes, let us try to explore this phenomena to understand this social media in better way. So guys, you must have seen friend of yours making a drone and then making its first flight in the backyard, shooting it and posting on the Facebook. Have you? It looks like yes. So what do? We praise him a lot. We give lot of likes, lot of comments, lot of shares, and makes him great. At the same time, there is somebody else who is part of Team Chandrayaan of ISRO, puts his video. What do? We also share a lot of things. We like him, we share him, and we praise him a lot also. But guys, there is a big, big difference between landing on moon with Chandrayaan and just playing a drone at the backyard. But we were unable to change our intensity of praise because this media just will not allow us to do it. Then what happens due to that is both guys feel same greatness. And that's disastrous because flying in the backyard is having less complexity, hence less challenge, but the Chandrayaan has more challenge. But if I'm getting great name and fame by just doing something in the backyard, why I will go for more challenging goals? That's the problem with the social media. So in a way, we are limiting somebody's capability just with flying in higher skies when he has the potential to go in the moon. Because people have started doing things for the sake of likes and shares and get a feel of greatness only when they get likes and comments. Why? Hence, I believe that we should be rational enough with our every click so that moderately talented people will not get the name and fame with the greatly talented people. And believe me, it's better for them because they can try their level best. And it's better for all of us as society. Now, let me tell you one more phenomenon which I could observe in last few years, especially in young people, that they are very excited about these new tools. Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter. They try to pose, they are fighting a lot on this media, and they feel that this media will bring the revolution, will bring their idea into reality. It's great, but I'm sorry. You are playing the battle in the wrong battlefield. Because Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, and all other medias are by its virtue of design are reactionary medias. There's a difference between reaction and response. So in these reactionary medias, we need new hero, new story, new cause every day. Hence, we just cannot pursue a long evolution which takes time to emerge in a big country like India on these media platforms. They will just vanish. But thanks to this social media, we also have responsive social media platforms such as change.org. They are not so famous in India, but there are many countries in the world where if there is a petition on change.org and it gets a million people's support, it is mandatory for the government to discuss that petition in the parliament of theirs and start the process of change. And believe me, the day is not far in India where that will be reality for us. So Maharashtra especially and India at large have seen lot of agitations, lot of morchas in last 2-3 years. You come on street for the cause you believe in, but believe me, in near future, your single click at right place will have same effect at going in the agitation. But the power of your click depends on on where you are clicking it. It should be at right place and right time, or else it will vanish its own power. So that were two social phenomena. Now let me come to the personal phenomena. Let me ask you a question. How many virtual friends do you have? Very few, right? By virtual, I mean the friends whom you have never met in person. You just interact with them on social media. You feel great attachment with them and you are happy with them. I was astonished when I realized this fact that I got great virtual friends in my journey of 9 years. I feel great attachment with them. I shared a lot and the friendship is flourished. But I also realized that these friendships never lasted. Every year I got new virtual friends and the old friends faded away from my life. The replacement happened because friendships on social media never lasts. On the contrary, I got many other friends with whom I interacted on social media first, then we met in person, and then the relationship flourished. But that has not happened with only virtual friends. Because people, social media is just a tool. It is just a starting point. Then we have to groom, we have to meet, we have to interact to build relationships. I wanted to point it out here because there will be many people, many young people here who want to date on Tinder, get engaged on Skype, get married on Facebook Live, and share their honeymoon photos on Instagram. Have a second thought because it's not that easy, buddy. Let me tell you, now let me take this thread of friendship ahead and ask you one serious question. Have you ever thought that on your feeds, on your news feeds, on your walls, why do you see posts, likes, videos of only certain friends and not all? Why? Because social media is not at all a reflection of real world. It is mostly run by algorithms. And those algorithms are designed in a way that they will always show you things that you like. So you will always get to see the feed of people who are of your thought process, who likes the same hero, who likes the same thought process, who likes the same ideology, who likes the same world leader, but you will never see the other side of coin. And that is disastrous. Because eventually, you will start feeling that in real world also, there is no other side exist. Everything happens as per my likes. Everything happens as per what I wish to. But it is not the reality. And that's why we are turning into a highly polarized and self-centric world. There is a huge debate going around the globe that what should we do with algorithms? As an engineer, I believe that algorithms needs to be there. They are necessary devil. You just cannot run Google and Facebook without algorithms. But my pity to this whole debate is the ultimate choice of algorithms should reside with us. User it at the top and everybody else comes down. What do I mean by this is, I am fine if I allow access to social media sites to show me algorithmic feed. I am aware at the subconscious mind that whatever I am consuming is algorithmic, filtered, and not the reality. But if I say that no, I don't want algorithms, I should see all the posts, all the comments, all the likes of all my 5,000 friends chronologically. Because that is my choice. This will lead to a transparent social media. In near future, when AI and all is coming and grooming, mutual coexistence of algorithms and human being are the only way for sustainable social media and sustainable society. It's a big thing, right? But have we thought it before? Have we thought it? It seems like the faces are blank. So let me ask you one more much serious question. Are we so casual about social media? Have we studied it in and out? What do I mean by this is, have we studied the socio-political impact, the psychological impact, the anthropological impact, the strategic impact of this media to us? We all are aware and we all accept that Barack Obama, Narendra Modi, and Donald Trump are the world leaders who won their elections because of social media. But have we studied them? Well, let me show you one interesting slide. This is a Google Scholar screenshot. I have put Barack Obama's social media on one side, and I have got thousands of research papers. I have put Narendra Modi and social media on the other side. I have got tens of papers. Why? Why haven't we studied it in detail? See, guys, social media is in its teenage now. It's been 12, 14 years that it is in India. And it is the right time to give a proper direction to this media. That will lead to sustainable future. But to give proper direction, we should understand it first. We should understand what is happening it, what is happening behind the curtain. And for that, research is the only basic building block. So I want to say and I want to push for that we need specific research centers based on social media, specific scholarships, specific journals, so that we can understand it in great detail and build a mindset of our country, of our countrymen around it. I will also like to push for social media as a part of school curriculum, because that will only lead to a sensible and sensitive future generation in this social media era. But guys, there is one more biggest bottleneck in the whole process. What do we do in social media? We create data and we consume data. Am I right? It looks like yes. But surprisingly, this data is not owned by us. And depressingly, most of the times, it is not even legal purview of our country, because the servers do not reside in our nation. It has been accepted worldwide that data is new oil. Every entity which will possess a lot of data will rule the world. Then what we are doing? We are creating new oil, but we are not owner of it. Why? Hence, we should push for a national social network. What do we mean by national social network? It is a network which is created, consumed, and monitored in our country, that is India. What will happen from this? At least we can have an access to the data for legitimate purpose, to keep the sanctity of this network alive. I know that it is not an overnight process. It will take years, but we should start taking gradual steps from today, from now onwards. And in between, what should do? We should Indianize the current social networks by asking them to keep their servers in India so that we can have a legal access to them. It is not at all for censorship. It is to keep the sanctity and authenticity of the media alive. It is to keep the basic principles of no censorship and freedom of speech alive. And we will not be the first to do it. Germany has already passed the law to curb the fake news just before a few days. European Union data harbor is already there with similar background. Canada, Australia are going in the same direction. China already has their own national social network. Then why we are not doing it? We can create our mindset and social framework of our country around that national social network. So guys, to sum it up, social media is here to stay and grow. We need to nourish the social media and use it for our betterment. And for that, we need to have a national and rational, which is more important, social media. We can do this by a single basic principle. That is, think twice. Think twice before every single click of your social media. Believe me, your every click matters a lot. Thank you.